Do you know why you killed those boys?
I do now.
I saw a young boy in his only in his briefs. He was tied up, had tape all over him, facial. He was mortally wounded, I could see. I don't know, I guess I'm boiling a little bit inside.
I know what you feel.
Someone does have him. We'd like to have him returned safely, please.
I hate what I did. I'm disgusted with what I did.
Christopher Walden's body was found at dusk last night in a remote area.
I committed the murder, sir.
John J. Jubert, 20, an airman from Offutt Air Force Base, was arrested tonight.
I'm not even going to try to justify it.
I thought it was in his best interest to plead guilty, yes.
John Jubert is more than someone who has murdered three children.
Jubert faces Nebraska's electric chair.
And John, I hope you're watching this because your time's up.
It shouldn't have happened.
Good evening, I'm Carol Kloss. It was just before dawn, Sunday, September 18th, 1983. Most people here in the town of Bellevue, Nebraska were still sound asleep. But something horrible was about to happen that would shatter the innocence of this community and change the lives of people here forever. It was a place where newspaper boys didn't think twice about heading out on their bikes alone. 13-year-old Danny Joe Eberly was one of those boys.
This little boy had energy that I've never seen in anybody else in my whole entire life. And he was very responsible. All his paper route money had gone to, like, saving for the bike that he got.
That Sunday morning, Danny Joe Eberly arrived at the Dairy Queen parking lot to begin his paper route. It was the last time his World Herald supervisor would see him alive.
The supervisor told Bellevue police he met Danny here behind the Dairy Queen and gave him approximately 70 newspapers plus the Sunday morning inserts. Bellevue police estimate that Danny probably spent between 10 and 15 minutes putting those inserts inside the Sunday papers, and then he left on his deliveries. Riding his bicycle, Danny then traveled south here along Madison Avenue. He made it as far as 23rd Avenue, the corner. From there, he made only three deliveries. His last stop was here at 2302 Madison, the home of Dr. Joe Troia.
As I looked out the screen door, I saw his bike with the papers on the handlebars. And the bike was leaning up against the fence right next to the gate.
Nearly 13 years later, Dr. Troia remembers going to church that morning, but when he returned, Danny Joe's bike was still there.
That was leaning up against the fence with all the papers in it. He had his papers in his paper bag. And we didn't know where he was. So I told my son, Joey, I said, Joe, why don't you get the bike and put it inside the fence.
He's very attached to his bicycle, which he abandoned. And this is something that the family stressed, that he really was in love with his bicycle. It was something that he wouldn't give up too easily.
And so about 8:15, his father came to the door. And he says, Doc, he says, have you seen my son? I said, no, Leonard. I says, I didn't see him. I know that his bike was outside there, the fence, and I brought it in. I says, you know, I think you better go down to the police department.
Police suspected Leonard Eberly's son had been kidnapped. They called in the FBI.
On Sunday morning, I got a call. I was coaching Little League football in West Omaha, and got a call from Bellevue police that Danny Joe was missing.
Omaha's FBI agent in charge, John Evans, and Sarpy County Sheriff Pat Thomas immediately joined the investigation.
The first job we had to do was hunt for Danny Joe, hunting all, and while that's going on, hunting up all his friends and making sure that he wasn't with them, known relative, haunts that he had, and we checked all those out. And that was all done within the first 15 hours, worked through the night that first night. And we pretty well knew that he'd been abducted.
Me and a couple friends of mine went through fields and in the Bellevue area, Hayworth Park, and looking for him because we knew something was up. Because, like I said, he was responsible. He didn't just blow off paper routes to go play with friends or something.
Have you seen Danny Joe Eberle? 2.5 days since the 13-year-old paperboy was last seen, there is still no satisfactory answer to that question.
Danny Joe's picture was plastered on telephone poles and TV. Tips poured into Bellevue Crime Stoppers.
This boy is from what we know about him, is a real fighter. If someone would have him, and I'm not saying they do have him, he'll do everything he can to get away.
But the community feared the worst. On Wednesday, 3 days after Danny Joe Eberle had disappeared, authorities organized a search.
200 or 300 people, and it was a real massive search, and Pat had all of his people there, and the FBI, and Bellevue, military, surrounding officers. So we really had a small army, I'd say, didn't we, Pat?
We had officers from all over eastern Nebraska come here.
And they told us to come out and take Platte Road from the river and walk westerly.
Wahoo Police Chief John Coulterman joined the search. He wondered how he'd ever find anything among the trees and tall grass. But less than a half hour into the search, he did.
We got to this area here down the ditch, close to the ditch, and one deputy was out further, kind of walked through the water. Sheriff was on the other side of the road, walking, looking. And all of a sudden, I just happened to look down and I just said, here he is. I saw a young boy only in his briefs. He was tied up, had tape all over him, facial. He was mortally wounded, I could see. And at that point in time, I walked back out on the road.
Wednesday morning, I was in foods class, and they just asked me to go to the office, and they told me to go get the car and go get the kids and go downtown to the police station. And, you know, you're thinking, well, if it was something good, they would have said, we found your brother. You know, they didn't say anything. And then we walked into the police station, and it's like all these solemn faces and, you know, I mean, just hanging their heads down, shaking their heads like, oh, and you just knew it.
Okay, just a few minutes ago, I took the father of Danny Joe Eberle to the morgue to identify him. The father identified it that the young man was his son.
I don't know, I guess I'm boiling a little bit inside.
What's the most disturbing part, Chief?
Well, I guess the condition of Danny Joe when I found him.
Danny Joe was wearing only a pair of black underwear shorts. He'd been stabbed many times, his throat slashed. Perhaps most disturbing were the teeth marks found on his body.
It's just so hard to imagine somebody doing that to a little boy.
It's got to be in another world. But someone that does that to a little boy, we felt it was unanimous, he'd do it again.
Flags flying at half staff, usually reserved for high government officials, the military, and presidents. This time, for a 13-year-old newspaper delivery boy. The murder of Danny Joe Eberle has tragically touched a deep chord in Bellevue.
I'm glad they found him.
Why is that?
Well, it's a relief to the family.
I think if they find the people that did it, they ought to get him to justice as quick as possible.
I knew him at school and stuff. He's a really nice kid and everything.
A young boy was dead, and somewhere in Bellevue, a murderer was loose.
It frightens me. I have a 10-year-old son.
As fear grew, so did resources dedicated to the case. 150 investigators, 59 FBI offices around the world, and a reward fund of more than $23,000. Hundreds of leads poured in each day. Most of them went nowhere.
Yeah, we had people that saw a green van, they thought, in this area, and we thought we'd maybe have, you know, a dozen or so green vans with Sarpy County tags. We had over 2,000 green vans with Sarpy County tags, and we checked every single one of them.
Lawmen had essentially one good clue, the rope used to tie Danny Joe Eberle's hands and feet.
It was a rope that had several plastic fibers that were of different color inside the rope. They were green, red, yellow, white, as I recall. They searched and searched and searched and couldn't find a match for it anyplace, couldn't find the location where it was made, which was making the rope more and more unique, which meant if we ever found a piece like it, it would be an extremely strong piece of evidence.
But for now, no rope, few clues and anxiety was growing. Police cruisers patrolled outside schools, and the sheriff feared the killer would strike again. It was a frigid morning, Friday, December 2nd. 11 weeks had passed since Danny Joe Eberle had been killed. 12-year-old Christopher Paul Walden was on his way to Pawnee Elementary School. The only child of Stephen and Sue Walden, Chris's mom often drove him. But the sun seemed to warm that cold winter day. So Chris walked and crossed paths with a murderer.
He spotted Christopher Paul Walden walking along. So he pulled over on the east side of the intersection and got out and crossed this 48th Street here and walked up behind him and put a knife through his throat and took him over to his car and put him in the car. And
Cheryl Baumgartner passed by on her way to work.
Well, at first I thought maybe it was a kid not doing what his parent wanted, and then I thought maybe it was a lover's quarrel. I mean, I really didn't think it was anything violent. I just, you know, really didn't think, I guess. I wish I would have done something about it. I regretted that the whole weekend.
Cheryl Baumgartner had just witnessed another abduction.
One thing authorities did confirm today, they definitely do not consider Christopher Walden a runaway. And judging by the number of officers now working on the case, nearly 100, that would certainly seem the case.
Desperate to find their son, Christopher Walden's parents appealed for help.
Very concerned about his whereabouts. Someone does have him. We'd like to have him returned safely, please.
But their plea proved futile. 3 days after their son's disappearance, a pheasant hunter made the gruesome discovery.
Christopher Walden's body was found at dusk last night in a remote area near 108th and Giles, west of Papillion. He had apparently been stabbed to death, just like Danny Joe Eberle in Bellevue last September.
Well, the body was lying there frozen, and his books and his knapsack and all of his belongings were stacked there.
That Sunday night when they came to tell me that they found his body, that was just agonizing, because I felt that was my fault. I mean, I thought if I could have found that car before Sunday night, this little boy would be okay. And I mean, it was horrible. And I mean, I talked to my priest and he said, don't you think the mother felt bad that she let him walk to school that day, and the teacher felt bad that she didn't report it? I mean, it's nobody's responsibility except the person that committed the crime.
Investigators now realize they were looking for a serial killer. But who could so brutally murder an innocent boy?
So if you imagine someone making you take your clothes off with just your shorts on and walking in the snow, and then making you lie down in the snow, and knowing that you're going to be killed, just it's unbearable, unbelievable. I mean, how you could...
Looking at that knife.
Yeah, you know, he's got the knife pointed at your, you know, held at your throat, and there's nowhere to go, and he's overpowering you. It would have to be a terrible, terrible feeling for a little boy to go through.
White male, 18 to 25 years old. 5'8", 160 pounds, dark hair, brown eyes, olive skin. This is the face of a killer, a sketch made with the help of witnesses who'd seen Walden's abductor. Finally, lawmen had something to go on.
Leads are coming forth now before possible contacts were made with other children in the area by a person that might have resembled that we gave you yesterday.
Investigators' adrenaline raced, while community panic grew.
Well, it's very scary. I'm, you know, very concerned, you know, so nothing happens, you know, to my children.
Police urged children to travel in groups. Many parents wouldn't let their kids out of their sight.
If they can get a child out here on our busiest street at a time when there are lots of people around, they can get them anywhere, and I'd just rather be safe than sorry.
I sent my daughter to my parents in Des Moines for that next week afterwards, because it was so, I mean, the whole city was terrorized, but this area particularly, because, I mean, this is our corner. I mean, you know, this is, you know, not even our neighborhood, our corner right here. And it was really scary, and not knowing who this person was or where they were.
Children at Pawnee School had more than just fear to deal with. They had lost a classmate. Special counselors helped them cope with their grief.
To think, if only I would have done something differently. But there isn't any way we can go back and change things.
Anxiety and grief were compounded by the fact that the murderer could be anywhere. All week long, investigators have contended they're hot on the killer's trail, but still no suspect has been apprehended. So many questions remain unanswered as to the whereabouts of the suspect and the type of vehicle he drove. And whether or not investigators know the answers, they're unwilling to say. Sheriff Thomas issued a challenge.
And I think that the individual who's responsible for these acts is very sick, spineless, a coward, and I would urge him to call a minister or a priest or me.
Now 5154, I'll never forget it.
January 11th, 1984, 5 weeks since the last murder. Suddenly, a major break in the case. The director of Aldersgate Methodist Church Preschool was getting ready for children to arrive. Barbara Weaver was alone in the basement when she noticed a car circling outside. To this day, she's too scared to show her face, but she remembers exactly what happened.
And I went over to the door and stood and waited because I expected him to come back around. And within another 30 seconds or to a minute, he did come back around again. And at that time, he pulled up head on. So he was sitting there looking into the window directly at me, and I was at the door. There was a window right next to the door, and I was standing there looking at him. And at that time, I was trying to memorize the license number. And after watching me for a while, he got out of the car and came to the door.
Instinctively, Barbara Weaver knew this was the man police were looking for.
He was very young. I was trying to memorize all that I could about his features. He wasn't much bigger than I was. I mean, he didn't appear to be any more than 18 or 19 years old to me. But I remember he had the prettiest eyes, and he just seemed to be... he was real frustrated. His voice was trembling. It almost appeared as if he were going to cry. He had a real broken spirit about him. The door was unlocked, so I knew I needed to be at the door so I could get out if I needed to. And so I opened the door and asked if I could help him. At that point, he asked for directions to a certain street. And I was trying to give him directions. And after the directions, he just shook his head in frustration like he didn't understand what I was telling him. And he asked if there were a phone there that he could use. And I said, no, there was not a phone. And at that point, he pushed me and said, get into the building or I'm going to kill you. And with all my might, I just pushed him and ran past him and ran down the street to the pastor's house.
She ran one direction, he ran the other one. And that, and these serial killers, they, the big thing in their procedure is control. And you've got to break that concentration of control. Mrs. Weaver did that.
Within minutes, authorities had a make on the suspect's car, a Chevy Citation from Beardmore Chevrolet, rented to a 20-year-old airman. His name, John Joubert. Authorities went to his barracks at Offutt Air Force Base. They found him asleep in his bunk. Inside his duffel bag, a piece of the rope with the multicolored strands.
John J. Joubert, that's J-O-U-B-E-R-T, 20, an airman from Offutt Air Force Base, was arrested tonight by the task force in connection with the Eberly Walden homicides.
The search had ended. John Joseph Joubert IV, born July 2nd, 1963 in Lawrence, Massachusetts, the only son of Beverly and Jack Joubert. Jack ran the local diner. When John was 8 years old, his parents divorced. A few years later, he moved with his mother and younger sister Jane to Portland, Maine. Here in this New England coastal town, John Joubert grew up.
I think he grew up in a very difficult home, with not only the parents' divorce, but a history of mental illness in the family.
For a long time, Joubert refused to talk about his childhood. But with coaxing from his friend Rich Petrie, Joubert is opening up. Petrie was Joubert's band teacher in high school. Coincidentally, Petrie was studying at Creighton University in Omaha the year Joubert was arrested. Through the years, he's become Joubert's close friend and spiritual counselor.
And he has always adamantly refused. Nothing is to be said about his family. That nothing negative, nothing period, because he wants to protect them at all costs. And I've been saying for years, you know, but really, you didn't get where you are out of the blue nowhere. There's a history here, and people should know about the history. And I said, look, your life is on the line here. And, all right, some people's feelings may be hurt, and so on. But the fact is, God willing, they'll get over it. You aren't going to get over the electric chair.
Now on death row, John Joubert's mother recently visited him and shared some deep, dark family secrets.
I don't remember any of this, but I have been told that my family life as a child was in turmoil. There were several loud arguments. My father would come home drunk. He would be abusive towards my mother. And at one point, just 2 months ago, my mother told me that I witnessed my father choking her until she passed out. I would have been standing in the hallway by my bedroom, and this took place in the hall. This is all buried. I don't have any memory of this, so it's all new.
Many of his childhood memories seem to be lost. Petrie says, as a young boy, Joubert was starved for affection from a father who wasn't around.
When John was 14, he hadn't seen his dad in quite a while, and he really wanted to see him. And I guess the dad was not coming to visit, and the mom wasn't taking him to see his dad. So he kept saying, I wanted to see my dad. So she basically said, as I understand it, so go. So he got on his bike and rode, it took him 2 days, rode 108 miles to where his dad was to visit his father. Stayed in some trailer on the way overnight. But, you know, obviously there was a huge need on his part for some sort of contact with his father. You know, for him to take that sort of, at that age, you know, this trip.
At home, Petrie says Joubert was suppressed by a demanding and overbearing mother.
He's never talked about physical abuse. My impression is that the mother was cold and extremely manipulative. And this I do know from his being a student here, overly controlling, imposing things, you know. I think that, you know, kids that age should be able to do for themselves or decide for themselves or whatever. You know, he was under a very, very tight leash.
Joubert's mother was determined that her son get a good Catholic education. So his freshman year, he enrolled here at Portland's only all-male Catholic high school, Chevres High.
He was a very good student in my class. He was an honor student.
Joubert's high school Spanish teacher, Francesca Bergen, remembers him as a timid yet respectful young man. He was on the track team, a model Boy Scout, earning the highest rank of Eagle. He played clarinet in the high school band under the direction of Rich Petrie. But class president Jim Champy says he doesn't remember much about John Joubert.
For the most part, but he was pretty transparent. Kind of just kept to himself, pretty, very quiet, very shy.
Well, he was a little boy all through his high school years, and he seemed to be picked on, and, you know, a lot of kids are picked on, but they seem to defend themselves, and I think because John did not defend himself, I don't know, sometimes I wonder if he thought he deserved that kind of abuse that he would get, the shoving, you know, the names, the teasing.
And I just sat there with a straight face, ignoring everything.
That's gotta build up some anger.
It does. Now, I tell people about it. I'm the same thing. There's a parallel today. I mean, I cross the yard for visits and I get this same taunting and teasing kind of thing. I talk about it and there is no anger.
Joubert graduated in 1981. Ironically, under his senior picture, he wrote, "Life is a highway with many roads branching off. Don't get lost." The next year, Joubert enrolled at Norwich University in Vermont. Free from his mother's rule, he let loose, skipped classes, and flunked out his freshman year.
He came back, after his freshman year at Yorwich, and we all said, there's something different about John. And nobody could put their finger on it.
It was that summer, 1982, Joubert's most serious problems began.
I committed the murders. The first murder, I killed Richard Stetson in Portland.
Danny Joe Everly and Christopher Walden were two of John Joubert's victims. There was another. In August of 1982, just about a year before Joubert moved to Nebraska, he found his first murder victim along this jogging trail in Portland, Maine. It was the evening of August 22nd, 1982. 11-year-old Richard Stetson was running around this cove.
At about the 1 mile mark is when people started seeing him with a person a little bit older than him, a young man on a bicycle.
John Joubert bicycled alongside the boy until they reached this area on the other side of the cove.
Over there by the factory is about where the crime scene was, where the body was found. Yes.
His body was found the next morning by a lady that was going to work. She noticed his body and she called the police.
Donald Stetson was 15 years old when his brother was killed. He's still haunted by the image of Richard's brutal murder.
He was strangled. He was knifed, and John took a bite out of his left calf. And dental experts from the state of Nebraska and the state of Maine took impressions, and they matched John's teeth.
For a year and a half, the Richard Stetson murder went unsolved. John Joubert joined the Air Force. Only after he confessed to killing two more boys in Nebraska would lawmen in Maine make the connection. January 11th, 1984, John Joubert, off at Airman, became John Joubert, accused child killer. Hours after he'd been arrested for accosting Barbara Weaver at Aldersgate Preschool, Joubert confessed to the murders of Danny Joe Everly and Christopher Walden.
What we'd like to have you do is, could to start with the first homicide that occurred.
Bellevue's former assistant police chief Don Carlson was one of the three officers who interviewed Joubert.
And all of a sudden, he just starts talking about it. None of us expected that. It caught the three of us totally by surprise.
Carlson had been part of the investigation since day one, and it was clear Joubert knew intimate details of Danny Joe Everly's abduction.
I pulled up with the cook's van on Mission Street to get something to drink. As I was drinking, I was drinking it outside and against the car. As I was doing that, I noticed this kid fixing his newspapers for the day.
Joubert said he drove down Madison Street and parked. He got out of his car and started walking toward Danny Joe.
When he turned his back on me to get on his bike, I grabbed him, put my hand over his mouth and a knife at his throat, and said, "You come with me, don't make any sound." He came with me. He didn't struggle at that time. He just came with me.
Joubert tied Everly's hands and feet, taped his mouth, and put him in the trunk of his car. The rope he used to tie up Danny Joe Everly had come from Joubert's Boy Scout leader. It was to be used on Boy Scout campouts.
I got in my car and drove on. Past the base lake, past base, onto the corner of that road and another one, I'm not sure of the name. He turned left onto the dirt road, approximately 100 feet. Stopped the car, shut it off, got out.
Joubert pulled Danny Joe out of the trunk and carried him to a ditch. He had Danny Joe take off all his clothes except a pair of underwear.
One of the ironic things on Danny's death was he had a black pair of undershorts on. And of course he knew that. We asked him that. Chuck asked him if he knew what color his shorts were, and he told us.
When I pulled out the knife, he said, "No, please don't kill me." I struggled a little bit then. And I stabbed him in the back. Yeah, done that. He told me that if I would take him to the hospital, he wouldn't say anything. I didn't believe him, so I stabbed him again a couple of times.
in the front or in the back?
All I can remember is stabbing in the back. Or I may have stabbed him in the front, but I can't remember. I also sliced the back of his neck. He wasn't moving, but I wasn't sure that he was dead or not, so I sliced his leg. Getting kind of scared then, so I just took the knife, got in the car, and drove off.
Joubert said he went back to his barracks and went to sleep. Later that night, he would attend a Boy Scout meeting. For more than 2 months after Danny Joe's murder, John Joubert went about his business at Offutt Air Force Base. No one ever suspected this shy young airman of doing anything wrong. But by December, Joubert's urge to kill was back.
Morning of December 2nd, it would have been a Saturday morning.
Joubert said he brought with him the same knife he had used on Danny Joe. This time, he spotted Christopher Walden walking toward Pawnee Elementary School. Once again, he parked and got out of his car. Joubert made Chris get down on the floor. The boy was crying. Joubert started driving. At first, he got lost and for a moment considered letting the boy go. Finally, he found his way to Cornhusker Road.
Ended up on a dirt road next to the railroad tracks that I came in. He got out of the car and bring him fix it. He did. And he started walking down the track along the river's woods. He turned into the woods. He walked for a little ways. And I told him that we'd stop here. And he did everything I told him to do. Nothing would happen to him. Told him to take off his clothes. If he did, he would have faced him. Put his clothes on. Put him on top of his shirt. All of his clothes, except for his underwear. Encouraged him to lay down on his back. When he had done that, I heard a knock on his chest and started strangling him. He was struggling. Looked like he was in pain. He was suffering too much, so I took out my gun and stabbed him.
Where did you stab
him? I stabbed him in the back a couple of times, and then I sliced his stomach. You know, it looked like he was dead. I sliced his stomach a couple of times just to make sure.
And from the evidence that we had, and when he confessed to us, everything matched.
With both confessions on tape, John Joubert was charged with 2 counts of murder. A quiet, polite man with a boyish face, not the typical image of a serial killer. Even with John Joubert behind bars, many people weren't ready to let down their guard. John Joubert changed the way we live our lives.
This was a nightmare for me, and I'm always going to watch him closer. I'll let it down a little bit, you know, but not never like I was before. And I think it's going to stick with me forever.
You never know who's walking the streets anymore.
Parents still picked their kids up from school, and kids still found safety in numbers.
Will you feel safe playing out in the streets now?
No, not that safe.
Omaha school policy on notifying parents of children's absence changed forever.
And we're going to continue to ask the parents to call us if their children are absent from school, to let us know if they are ill. If we don't get a call, we will call the home.
People were no longer so trusting. If a Boy Scout leader could harm children the way Joubert had, who could you trust?
The boys were close to him. They enjoyed his company. They enjoyed being with him. And they're just as confused as I am.
Scoutmaster Donald Shipman was shocked by Joubert's arrest. As his assistant scout leader, Joubert had gone on campouts with the troop.
I've been very introspective, trying to see that if this young man that I am acquainted with is capable of committing those crimes, and I cannot reach a decision.
Joubert worked in this building. His co-workers said he was just an average sort of person and expressed shock and dismay at his arrest. In this maintenance shop at Offutt Air Force Base, Joubert had worked side by side with 50 other airmen. Ironically, the composite picture of the killer had been posted on this bulletin board. No one had suspected Joubert for a moment. His former high school classmates in Portland, Maine, were in total disbelief.
I don't know, I never saw him get physically. He always seemed to be too small at Shevers to be physical with anybody. Everybody was always bigger than him.
As time went on, it became clear John Joubert, Boy Scout leader, Offutt airman, and model student, was the man responsible for these atrocious acts. Single-handedly, he'd held an entire community hostage. But with the killer finally behind bars, people began to feel a sense of relief. As for the victims' families, they too felt relief, but not much satisfaction.
Oh, relief, definitely. Relief, but then it's like there's nothing that's going to bring Danny back. So, you know what I mean? It's like it wasn't happy. It was just like, I'm good, at least he won't do it to anybody else.
John Joubert never faced trial in Sarpy County. July of 1984, he pleaded guilty to two counts of murder. In October of that year, he was sentenced to death. Joubert did face trial in Portland, Maine. There, he was convicted of murder and sentenced to the maximum of life in prison. He was later returned to Nebraska, where he now awaits the electric chair.
Again, I can't do anything except apologize. Oh, and I am sorry. And it shouldn't have happened.
John Joubert has spent the last 12 years on death row. This may be his final week.
John Joubert's dead on Friday. Face it. He's a dead man.
We'll pray for you.
Don't pray for me. I pray for the children he killed.
To this day, most people in Nebraska believe Joubert deserves to die. But what about the victims' families? How do they feel?
I'm glad in a way that the state of Nebraska caught him before the state of Maine did, because Nebraska does have capital punishment. The state of Maine doesn't. And I'm going to feel a lot better after this guy is executed. And John, I hope you're watching this, because your time's up.
I don't want him out, and I don't want him to sit there and, you know, get 4 degrees in college, you know, and just have this happy life. But I don't know. I don't know how I feel.
But on the other hand, you don't necessarily want him dead.
I don't know. I can't answer that, because, I mean, I just don't think, like I said, if it was going to bring Danny back, you bet. You know, if I get to see my brother and give him a big hug, yeah. But he's not going to be back. I mean, and he took him away, and there's no really good feeling about it. I mean, death is death for anybody, you know.
As for Joubert himself,
I don't think anyone deserves to die. The death penalty is not being administered fairly. And if it doesn't deter anybody, I mean, look at the Otay execution. They killed Willie Otay in 1994, and you could go through your own file tapes, and you probably know better than I do how many murders there have been just since then. Do you really think any of those people said, well, wait a minute, they killed Otay, I better not kill this person, or they might do the same thing to me? I mean, no one thinks about this.
Did you think about the death penalty when you came to Nebraska?
No, I never did. I never thought about getting caught. Let me change this. I mean, when I first came to Nebraska, I never thought about committing any crimes. Once I did, I never thought about getting caught either.
You thought you were smarter than that?
No, I never thought about not getting caught. It just, for some reason, wasn't an issue. I wasn't able to think beyond acting out the obsession.
Psychiatrist who interviewed Joubert after the murder said he had a schizoid personality disorder with obsessive compulsive behavior. Omaha psychiatrist Dr. David Kensmith wrote, "Such persons are at high risk to repeat their crimes. There are several instances in which such individuals who were thought to have been successfully treated, once released from a secure and controlled setting, resumed a pattern of murdering."
Do you think that you're reformed at all?
I believe that I would never kill anyone again, if that's what you mean by reformed. Yes, I know that I could never harm anyone.
How can you believe that? How can you know that?
I can know it. I can know it because I can see people. I can empathize with people. This is something that was absent for me when I was on the streets. I can know it because I can look at what I've done and know that it disgusts me and that I hate that part of myself. And because I'm in touch with my feelings now and not hiding from them, how you can know it, well, two things. One, you never can know because obviously you're not gonna, I'm never going to be trusted again. And second, I'm never going to be released, so it's never going to be put to the test.
He is a cold-blooded killer, and that's just the way he is. And like he said, if you let me out, I'll just go kill someone today, or try to kill somebody today. And he's that way all the time. He liked to be around little boys, and, but I think he used those younger friends so that he could continually to hunt. And he wasn't so obvious by himself because he was in with those younger people while he was hunting, looking for his victims.
It was part of the plot.
Part of the plot, part of the plan.
Yeah.
That's not true. It's just not.
How do you explain what you did to innocent boys?
I don't. It's been suggested, and I've even thought of this, maybe I was taking it out of myself. These boys were at the age when I would have felt the strongest and earliest desires for independence. I just know it's a theory. There are other things. I mean, part of what makes me believe that there really were loud arguments between my parents is my response to arguments today. I can hear an argument between two people that has absolutely nothing to do with me, and I'm nervous, and my stomach flips, and I want to leave the room. That makes no sense. It's this anxiety that I feel. I mean, and the fantasies took that away.
I hear that in some ways you got a lot of gratification out of the killings. Describe.
The murders provided material for the violent fantasies. That's all of the gratification there was.
How so? What do you mean it provided material for the violent fantasies?
The fantasies were accompanied by self-stimulation. I could think about the murders again. And they, some of the fantasies paralleled the murders.
Some of the psychiatrists said that you saw violence and sex as almost the same.
Not really. I wasn't sexually aware then. I wasn't... Well, I hadn't had sex. I was 20 years old. Nowadays, a 20-year-old not having sex seems to be a virtue. Then it wasn't. And then it was actually an object or a reason for ridicule. At any rate, that's a digression. No, I wasn't confusing violence and sex. Sex just wasn't an issue.
Did you continue to have the fantasies in prison?
Yes. Oh, yes. It was around 1990 that I started making success in stopping them.
How?
Sheer willpower, nothing else. I would just say, that's it, that's enough. I'm not going to do this anymore. I could do that for 2 or 3 days. And they'd come back. Eventually, I couldn't keep them out of my head. Some point in 94 and 95, the end of 94, early 95, I started asking people if they knew anyone on the streets who would be willing to volunteer their services, a therapist, a psychologist. So I started working with the psychologist in February of 95. We've been working for 16 months. We've made a lot of progress.
Joubert attributes much of his progress to his new love, Teresa O'Brien of Ireland. The mother of 3 children, she began corresponding with Joubert a few years ago. O'Brien is here now to share Joubert's final days.
I don't like the term girlfriend. It's very, I don't know, it's almost demeaning. It doesn't sum up what John and I have together. We're best friends. We love each other dearly. We share everything. I know.
Teresa O'Brien is now Joubert's strongest advocate.
People talk about John as a monster, and nobody's willing to think about him as a man who is 12 years later has spent a hell of a lot of time thinking about this and searching himself and talking about himself, trying to find a reason. And nobody really wants to know that. And if I have said that in one of the interviews I did, I said that, and I got a responding letter which said that I was being duped, that John was a predator then and is a predator now and is preying on me. And that, I find that hurtful, because I know this man. I've been writing to this man every day for the last 3 years.
Many people in Nebraska cannot see beyond John Joubert's monstrous acts. The memory of his brutal crimes will haunt them forever.
I still get very emotional over the parents. The 4 parents, those poor, pitiful times they had to go through. And Pat knows this better than I do, the number of police officers who died in their 40s prematurely that worked on this case. I think the number is about 5 or 6, isn't it, Pat? Heart attacks. And it just, it just shouldn't have happened, that's all. It's a warped time in history for us. And those are the heroes, the parents and, of course, our 2 little precious boys and then those lawmen and those families. Those are the heroes. I don't even think of this other guy that's in the hands of the people of Nebraska now.
I recognize that the law enforcement people are part of the community as well, and I apologize to them as well.
They have seen a lot of the things that the community hasn't seen.
I know. They saw, they picked up the bodies. I know this. I can imagine there were nightmares from that. I know exactly what they saw.
You did it.
I know. That's what I mean. And it's never left my mind, and I know it's never going to leave theirs. And I can't take that away.
I don't think people realize how much even witnesses are affected by this. I mean, you know, the families, I can't even imagine how they must feel. But I mean, what it does to your life just to have witnessed something, I mean, it's unbelievable.
What, if anything, that you could hear from him, would you want to hear?
Nothing.
Just nothing that...
I don't believe his apologies are totally sincere. And they might be, I don't know, but nothing. Nothing at all.
It's too late.
Oh, yeah. It was too late right after that. I mean, there's nothing that that man could tell me that would make me feel better at all.
Mm-hmm. What about why? Would you like to know that?
No, because I just think he's a sick man. I mean, I don't even know that he knows why. And nothing. Like, I've went over that, too. It's like, what would make me feel better? Not a darn thing.
The clock is ticking for John Jubert. He spends his time visiting friends and consulting with attorneys, hoping for a reprieve.
And you don't see any justification to removing John Jubert from the face of this earth?
You tell me, what one good thing will it do?
Perhaps take away people's fear that you could ever get back out on the street and do what you did again?
It's already done. I will sign any paper that will keep me in prison for the rest of my life. John Jubert is more than someone who has murdered 3 children. John Jubert has been alive for almost 33 years. I was on the streets for 20 years before I was arrested. And I certainly did a whole lot more in my life before then, and I've done a whole lot more in my life afterward. And the public knows nothing of this.
I don't know if they care to.
You're right, they probably don't, but they've never been told either.
You could never forgive him.
Never. Nope. And never. You know, these two boys, and Richard Stetson, I don't know too much about him, but I mean, they had so much going for, I mean, that was just taken away from him.
Here you are, pleading for your life, and back 12 years ago, you sat with those boys pleading for their life, and you didn't listen to them.
That's right.
Why should we listen to you?
Because you're not me. You're not who I am, you're not... You're not killers.
Barring any last-minute delays, John Jubert will die in the electric chair this Friday. Some people think the story ends there, but there are too many people touched in too many ways and too many memories scarred by the crimes of John Jubert. I'm Carol Kloss. Good night.